All right, Genesis 36, we read the whole thing. Now, I'm not going to go through every single verse by verse like I normally do with these chapters. We see here, this is the, basically, it's talking about Esau and his descendants and his family and his relatives, his the Edomites. And it tells us very explicitly, you know, this is in the first verse. Now, these are the generations of Esau. Who is Edom? Now, you hear about Edom all throughout the Old Testament. You hear about the Edomites and Edom. And basically who that is the descendants of Esau. And we saw that earlier in Genesis when they were naming Esau because he was hairy and red all over. That's also another reference to Edom. Now, this chapter obviously deals all about Edom, and you're going to see real familiar names within this chapter as you read it, because as you read the Bible, the names of cities and places were mostly generally named after the person, right? So like Dan has, you know, all the tribes had their areas. This is the tribe of Judah and Naphtali and all these other places. But then even the cities would carry the name of the founding father of that city, the founding person. They would change names sometimes of cities to be the name of their ancestor, you know, the person who took it over to be their name. And they refer to, you know, the city of David, which is Jerusalem. Now, they didn't actually change the name, but there's a lot of places where they did change the name. So when you read this, you're going to see a lot of familiar names. And the reason why I see familiar names is because these are the actual descendants and the original ancestors that started these cities. And when we see the dukes, right, a duke is just a ruler. It's a ruler over a smaller territory. So like a king has an entire kingdom. A king has an entire realm that they lord over, that they rule over and they reign over. But a duke is over a much smaller section or area. And we see these dukes that came forth of Esau's descendants because they were rulers of all these different areas in the land of Edom, in Esau's territory, in this land that he's inhabiting. So that's a general overview of everything. We're not going to get into some specific points, though, because also, you'll notice as you read the Bible that Edom is basically a heathen land. I mean, it's not a righteous land. We see, keep your finger here, turn if you would to Amos chapter 1. We see a lot of problems with the inhabitants of Edom. We see that they reject God. They're a heathen land. And if you remember when you know, this is obviously still early on in Esau's days, and it's talking about his descendants and his very near descendants, not going generations and generations beyond. It's just pretty much his immediate sons and maybe their sons. You know, that's about as far as we get in this type of genealogy in chapter 36 of Genesis. But later on, much later on, after the children of Israel, because, you know, you have Israel, they go into Egypt with the famine. Right, Israel is Jacob, it's Esau's brother. They go into Egypt when there's the famine, when Joseph makes himself known unto his family, you know, and that's when all the descendants of Israel, they're all still alive, and they're all living in Egypt, and they sojourn in Egypt, and then they're there for a while. And then the pharaohs and the people die that knew Joseph and knew all those things, and the children of Israel were multiplying because they were having children and they were starting to grow physically in number, and the Egyptians were getting scared of them, so they put them into bondage. And you know, they were in bondage. They were in Egypt for like 430 years, the Bible says. That's how long they stayed there before God, you know, before Moses came along and God delivered them out of Egypt, right? And then Moses brings them through. That's like over 400 years after this time, after the time of Jacob and Esau. So 400 years later, Moses comes along. I mean, 430, but, you know, essentially 400 years later, Moses comes along. He leads them out of Egypt. And then they're wandering in the wilderness. And when they're going to go into the promised land, Edom doesn't let them pass through his borders. Edom comes out, and they actually come out with an army, with a force, and they say, no, you aren't coming through here. Because they say, you know, just let us pass through your land. We won't take anything. Anything that we eat, we'll pay you for. Any water that we drink, we'll pay it for, you know, pay for it. We just want to have a travel along the king's highway. Just let us go through the highway of your land so that we can go over to the other side, over to the promised land that God promised for us. And they said no. And they wouldn't allow it. They wouldn't stand for it. They came out against them. So this is many years later. But what you'll see is that the Edomites, just the wickedness of the Edomites, how they came to be after, of course, hundreds of years later. It's still a long time down the road, but it's Esau's descendants basically just get more and more wicked as time goes by. And because they had done that, though, and this is real interesting, if you're in Amos chapter 1, look at verse 11. It says, "Thus saith the Lord, for three transgressions of Edom, and for four, I will not turn away the punishment thereof, because he did pursue his brother with a sword, and did cast off all pity, and his anger did tear perpetually, and he kept his wrath forever. But I will send a fire upon Teman, which shall devour the palaces of Bozrah." So you remember Teman, right? Teman was one of the sons of Esau, or of Esau's children. We saw that name here. He's a descendant of Esau, and that's because the land that he's referring to of Teman was founded by his one of his immediate descendants. And we see God carrying out punishment oftentimes against nations many years later, or hundreds of years later even, because they did that back when Moses was trying to lead them in. Once they got into the promised land, there was the time of the judges, and then they set up and established a king. And when Amos was writing, when the word of the Lord came unto Amos, in the beginning of chapter 1, it tells you it's during the reign of King, I'm not to the page now, but it's Uzziah, right? And around the time of Jehoram. So like this is kind of in the middle of the reign of the king. So this is a long time afterwards. But God brings this judgment. Turn, if you would, to Malachi chapter 1. Malachi chapter 1. Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament before you get to the New Testament. It's the last book of the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 1. And we're going to go through this a little bit regarding Edom. Look at verse number 1. The Bible reads, "The burden of the word of the Lord to Israel by Malachi. I have loved you, saith the Lord, yet ye say, wherein hast thou loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, saith the Lord? Yet I loved Jacob, and I hated Esau, and laid his mountains and his heritage waste for the dragons of the wilderness. Whereas Edom saith, we are impoverished, but we will return and build the desolate places. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, they shall build, but I will throw down, and they shall call them the border of wickedness, and the people against whom the Lord hath indignation forever." That last verse, or verse 4, that's talking about the Edomites. This is who we're reading about in Genesis 36. I mean, how bad do you have to get before God says, you know, hey, you're going to try to build up the city, and I'm just going to throw it right down. I'm going to frustrate all of your efforts. And he says, "And they shall call them," call the Edomites, "the border of wickedness, and the people against whom the Lord hath indignation forever." Basically, it's a people that are just completely rejected by God. God has indignation against them forever. This is the wickedness of Edom. And you see this as you read through the Old Testament. You see different instances where they're doing wicked things, and God's bringing judgment upon them, and different prophets are preaching against them. And the reason why I'm pointing all of this out is because we're reading about their beginnings and their origins. And I believe strongly, obviously, everyone's responsible for their own actions. But when you see the origins of a people and of a place, you know, Esau himself, we already have read through a lot about Esau and his character, and how he sold his birthright for a bowl of soup. And you know, he wasn't the best character. You know, he married the heathen wives. He did these things that just weren't, he just wasn't quite right. He wasn't right with God. And he acted more carnal, and he acted more on impulse. And we see that just his descendants basically turn into a wicked people. And you think of the Lot too, right? Lot with his incestuous children, Moab and Ammon, they became extremely wicked nations as well. They were born in a very, very poor environment, and they turned out to be a wicked people as well. But I wanna kind of use Malachi 1 to transition. I covered this previously with Edom and Esau and Jacob and what the Calvinists like to use. But I want to point out here what we saw here in Malachi 1:2. It says, I have loved you, saith the Lord, yet ye say, wherein hast thou loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, and saith the Lord, yet I loved Jacob and I hated Esau. So this is real interesting. A lot of people these days don't even realize that this verse exists in the Bible. Because first of all, you have the false view that God loves everybody all the time, no matter what. That God, well, you say, well, God is love. God just loves every single person. That's not true. That is false. We see an example right here where he says, you know, was not Esau Jacob's brother? Yet I loved Jacob and I hated Esau. Now, what's important to understand here, though, is that and you can read from other places, you know, God's hatred of people and people who do things. I preach an entire sermon about that, about a time to hate and when to hate and how God hates people. And, you know, there's people that God gives up on and they become reprobate. They can't even put their faith on Christ because their heart has been hardened. And but I don't want to get into all of that tonight. I want to cover what we're referring to in Malachi and then in Romans 9. If you want to get your finger ready in Romans 9, we're going to turn there next because that is the go-to chapter for the Calvinists. And the point that they try to make with this is their predestination, their election, where they say that God picks and chooses in advance without anything that you do, just this person will be saved and this person won't. And they refer to this term, part of their tulip, as irresistible grace, where God just gives you grace and you can't even resist it. And you get saved because God has chosen you, because you are elected of Him with basically nothing, with you having no say in the matter whatsoever, which is a total lie and it's completely false. So we see here in Malachi 1, he says, yet I loved Jacob and I hated Esau. And he says, and laid his mountains and his heritage waste for the dragons of the wilderness. And then he says, whereas Edom saith, now he's referring to Edom. Edom was Esau, but it's talking about the whole land of Edom. It's talking about a group of people. This isn't talking about the individual, and we'll see that a little bit later. Let's look at Romans chapter 9. Flip, if you would, to Romans chapter 9. Because we're going, and I'm not going to cover this too in depth. I already did earlier in a previous chapter in Genesis. I don't remember if it was like chapter 24 or 26. I don't remember exactly. But I covered this pretty well in depth. I'm gonna touch on it tonight. But since we're covering the entire chapter of the descendancy of Edom, but look at Romans chapter 9. We're going to start reading in verse number 10. Because this is the place that they'll like to turn to and tell you that, see, it doesn't matter if you do right or wrong. God just chose who is going to be saved and who wasn't. So in verse number 10 of Romans chapter 9. And look, this is important. As a Christian, you need to be able to answer for these things. Because it's one thing to know. It's pretty easy to understand salvation by grace through faith. It's easy to get saved. It's easy to know that that's true. And you can see all these other scriptures that you know is there for support. And it completely backs up what you believe. But sometimes there's verses that can be like a little bit tricky. A little bit, you know, it's like, well, wait, what does that mean? And usually the reason why they're tricky is because someone else brings them up to you and giving you a false view on it right from the beginning. So when they get you into their way of thinking, you start thinking about it like, wait a minute, what is this saying? Because you start to see the contradiction immediately. If someone tells you, well, no, God just picks and chooses, you know, and then you're like, well, wait a minute, what about, you know, whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely? You know, what about God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance? You know, you start thinking about these different verses that you know, and be like, well, these are really clear. Like, I know that. So what do you mean God picks and chooses who he wants to get saved and who he wants to give his grace to? It doesn't make any sense. Look at verse number 10 of Romans 9. The Bible says, and not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by one, our father Isaac, for the children, this is the verse I like to look at, for the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth, it was said unto her, the elder shall serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. So remember, we just looked up that reference in Malachi. Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated. We saw that. And we saw him cursing all the people of Edom in context of Malachi chapter 1. So now let's look at here in Romans 9, it says, you know, and what they like to do is it says here, the elder shall serve the younger. And it says that God chose that before they were even born, right? Before they did anything good, before they did anything bad, before Esau sold his birthright, before any of this stuff even happened, God said the elder shall serve the younger. So this is what they'll say, is that, see, God has chosen, and that because it says that according to election might stand, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. First of all, we're going to see if this is even talking about the individual, because that's what they apply it to. They'll say this applies to Jacob and Esau individually. Well, flip back, if you would, to Genesis 36, where we were, because there is an important passage in Genesis 36 that can give us an idea if we see Esau serving Jacob. Now, up to this point, we're going through Genesis chapter by chapter. Have we ever seen one instance of Esau serving Jacob? Of Esau doing, you know, in a position where Jacob is in authority over him, Jacob has all the wealth, Jacob has all this stuff, and he's telling Esau what to do. And Jacob and Esau is serving Jacob. No. If anything, we saw the opposite when Jacob was coming back into the land and he's giving all these gifts unto Esau because he didn't want his brother to kill him. We did see that. But we did not see the opposite. We didn't see Esau coming and giving him all this stuff and serving him and everything else. We didn't see that once. And in Genesis 36, look at verse number 6. It says, and Esau took his wives and his sons and his daughters and all the persons of his house and his cattle and all his beasts and all his substance which he had got in the land of Canaan and went into the country from the face of his brother Jacob. So he took all of his stuff, everything that he had, and he moved out into the country. Right? It says, away from his brother Jacob. Why? Why did he do that? Why did he pick up all this stuff and move out? Verse number 7, for their riches were more than that they might dwell together, and the land wherein they were strangers could not bear them because of their cattle. They were both very wealthy. They both had so much substance. They had so much cattle, so much stuff, they couldn't even live by each other. He said, I just have to move over here because there's not enough land to contain everything that God has blessed us with. They both were extremely wealthy in this land, and they had to separate just because of logistics, just because they needed the land for their own cattle. So if this is the case and he has all this wealth, where do we see Esau serving Jacob ever? Not one time in the Bible. But you know what we do see? We do see Edom serving Israel, serving Jacob later on. Turn if you would to, turn if you would real quick to Genesis chapter 5. Because the point is, the scripture cannot be talking about the individuals, Jacob and Esau. And we need to look at all of the references in order to understand this. So when someone wants to bring you to Romans 9, the best way to make sure you're not confused about it is say, oh, wait, hey, look, this is quoting the Old Testament. Oh, this is referring back to another story. This is referring back to when Rebecca had the children. And they're quoting this. Well, let's go back and take a look at that so we could maybe have a proper understanding of what they're trying to teach in the New Testament. Genesis 25, verse 22, reads, and the children struggled within her. And she said, if it be so, why am I thus? And she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. And the one people shall be stronger than the other people. Now, did she have a whole bunch of people in her womb? No, she had two. Jacob and Esau. And he's talking about the one people and the other people. He's not talking about the person and the other person. He didn't say, and it says, and he says, and the elder shall serve the younger. And in context here, when he says the elder shall serve the younger, because that's what's quoted in Matthew, in Romans, I think, Romans chapter 9. I'm like, Matthew 9? No, it's not Matthew 9. Romans 9. In Romans 9, that's what's quoted. The elder shall serve the younger. And they're saying, you know, that the purpose of God, according to election, might stand. The elder's going to serve the younger. See, Jacob, you know, Esau served Jacob. No, it's the nations. And in context, when you look at this verse up, he's talking about two nations, two manner of people, and the people, one people is going to be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger. People. Every time it's plural, it's talking about a group of people. It's talking about the descendants, who is actually going to be coming from both of those two patriarchs, both of the Esau and Jacob, because they both had many descendants after them because God blessed them. God had blessed Abraham, he blessed Isaac, and he blessed Jacob and Jacob's children and Isaac's children. I mean, he blessed Esau. And even when he was giving him the promised land, you know, he didn't give him the land of Edom. He said, no, that's for Esau. That's his land. That's the land that I've given him. We see Esau being blessed of God tremendously with all this wealth. We do not see him serving the younger, and it's referring to the nations. And this actually gets fulfilled. Turn, if you would, to 2 Samuel 8. I want you to see this. 2 Samuel chapter number 8. Because we see the fulfillment in Scripture of the elder serving the younger. We saw that it's the nations. 2 Samuel chapter 8. This is during the reign of King David, is when this finally is just comes to pass. Verse 14, 2 Samuel 8 reads, and he put garrisons in Edom. A garrison is a military unit. He has his military bases set up in the land of Edom because now he's controlling that land. And he put garrisons in Edom throughout all Edom. He garrisons, and all they of Edom became David's servants. And the Lord preserved David whithersoever he went. Now, who's David? He's a descendant, right, of the tribe of Judah, which is a descendant of Israel. He's a direct descendant of Jacob. He's in that family tree. So here we see an Edom, our direct descendants of Esau. And Esau ends up serving Jacob through David. Through, I mean, it's the whole land of Israel. I mean, it's David is leading. He's the king of Israel. The Edomites serve the Israelites. This is the fulfillment of that prophecy saying the elder shall serve the younger. It happened. This is exactly where we can see that in Scripture. And this is where you'll find that. You don't find Esau the man serving Jacob the man. Now let's look at the beginning of chapter 13. Turn back if you would to Genesis 36. I just want to point that out real quick, because don't let someone turn you around on this Calvinistic doctrine saying that God picks and chooses what's going to happen with the people. If they want to go to Romans chapter 9, it's very, very, very simple what Romans 9 is talking about. It's not talking about God picking and choosing salvation. It's not saying that, see, just because Esau didn't even have to do anything. It's the elder serving the younger. And it's prophecy of what's going to happen in the future. It was prophetic. It wasn't something that Esau was just damned as a person. The Bible doesn't say anything like that. But let's look here. There's another very interesting. A lot of people might get bored with this chapter. And I could understand that. The first few times I started reading the Bible, chapters like this were extremely boring. And you're tempted just to skip over them, because you look at it and you're just like, your eyes start to gloss over. And you're like, man, that's just a lot of names. But the Bible says, first of all, it says that every word of God is pure. The Bible says that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for doctrine, for instruction, and for instruction in righteousness. And my mind just completely went blank on the rest of that verse. But everything in the Bible is important. Nothing is here by accident. Nothing's here just, well, that's not for us. We can learn from all this stuff. And I just kind of glossed over the overview of Edom and what that means in the Bible. But there's a lot more to be learned specifically from this chapter. And hopefully this will encourage you. When you come across this and you get bored, I would challenge you, do a study with it. Tell yourself, what if I had to teach on this chapter? What would I teach? And you start going through with that type of an attitude, and you will learn a lot. You start looking things up. Check this out, because I think a lot of people, like I didn't even know this before, to be honest with you, until I started preparing for this sermon. And a few weeks ago, I looked ahead, and because I've been looking ahead at what I'm going to preach, and I started thinking, like, man, this is going to take some time, because this is going to involve a lot of extra study above and beyond what I already know and what I've been looking into. So one thing I found very interesting here is look at verse number 2 of Genesis 36. It reads, Esau took his wives of the daughters of Canaan, Ada, the daughter of Elon the Hittite, and Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna, the daughter of Zibeon the Hivite, and Bashemath, Ishmael's daughter, sister of Nebaioth. Now, by the time you get to this point in Genesis, you've already read from Genesis 26 and chapter 28 that, yeah, we know Esau took wives of the heathen. We know that he took two wives of the Canaanites. And then you remember Rebekah saying to Isaac, saying, you know, I don't want Jacob to marry. It was vexing them that Esau took wives of the Canaanites. So she sent Jacob away to go marry one of their relatives, one of his cousins, right? And he says, I don't want to marry the women of this heathen land. We know that already. We saw that. We read that. So when you read this, it's easy to read over this. And then remember, he said, oh, when he saw that it pleased them that Jacob was going to marry like a relative, then he took a daughter of Ishmael. Because Ishmael, of course, was Abraham's son, right? So this was his way of trying to please his parents. He took another wife. We saw that already. But so as you read this, it doesn't really necessarily jump out at you until you actually look it up. And we're going to look at, keep your finger here in Genesis 36 and flip back to Genesis 26. We're going to do some side-by-side comparisons. Because you say, okay, yeah, two daughters of the Canaanites and Ishmael, right? Which is what we've already seen in the past. But look at Genesis 26. In 36, we see he married Ada and Aholibamah and Bashemath. Look at Genesis 26, verse 34. And Esau was 40 years old when he took to wife Judith, the daughter of Beeri the Hittite, and Bashemath, the daughter of Elon the Hittite, which were a grief of mine unto Isaac and to Rebekah. Now, we didn't see a Judith when we were reading in Genesis 36. Now look at Genesis 28, verse number 8. It says, and Esau, seeing that the daughters of Canaan pleased not Isaac his father, verse 9, then went Esau unto Ishmael, and took unto the wives which he had Mahalath, the daughter of Ishmael, Abraham's son, the sister of Nebaioth, to be his wife. Mahalath isn't mentioned either. And what's even more interesting is when we saw it back in Genesis 26, Bashemath, the daughter of Elon the Hittite, the Bashemath that he married in Genesis 36 was Bashemath, Ishmael's daughter, sister of Nebaioth. So if you compare Genesis 36, verse 3, first we'll just look at the wife of Ishmael that he married. Genesis 36 says Bashemath, Ishmael's daughter, sister of Nebaioth. Genesis 28 says Mahalath, the daughter of Ishmael, Abraham's son, the sister of Nebaioth, to be his son. Two different names. Now, there's a couple different ways of looking at this. Because we know that there's no contradictions in the Bible. It's not like it's just contradictory and say, wait a minute, that's, you know, the Bible's stupid, this is just wrong. There's different explanations for this. One is to say, well, Bashemath and Mahalath are the same person, but they have different names. Now, we've seen many people getting different names throughout the Bible. That's nothing new. You see Simon, Cephas, Peter, they're all the same person. Saul got Paul, Abram changed to Abraham, Sarai changed to Sarah. We see people who get different names and sometimes very different sounding and looking names than each other. So one way of looking at this is saying, okay, well, That Bashemath, Ishmael's daughter, and Mahalath, Ishmael's daughter, are the same person, but it's referring to them as different names. I don't believe that. I think they're different people. Now, the reason why we see these people in Genesis 36 is because it's going through the descendants. So these are the women who actually gave birth to sons that that Esau had. So this is the whole purpose of them. Purpose of them even being mentioned here in Genesis 36 is because it's saying, okay, this one, you know, this wife bare these children, this wife bare these children, and it's talking about the sons specifically, not even the daughters. You know, I mean, he might have had daughters with these other wives. We don't know, but when you look at it, you see. What else is interesting, in Genesis 36, he marries Ada, the daughter of Elon the Hittite. And in Genesis 26, he married Bashemath, the daughter of Elon the Hittite. So two daughters of the same person, which would be the same thing with Ishmael, which means, and what I believe, he married two sets of sisters. Now, one reason for this, and we're going a little bit above and beyond and into a little bit of conjecture here, but we could see for sure when it says, you know, he had more than three wives. I'll tell you that. He had to have more than three wives. And the reason why I know that for a fact, even if you want to think, well, they might be the same person, but different names, is because he married a daughter of Elon the Hittite, okay, in each place. You want to say that's the same person? Okay. But he married Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna, the daughter of Zibeon, the Hivite. Being a daughter of Anna and daughter of Zibeon is nowhere mentioned anywhere else. And then in Genesis 26, when he married Judith, that's the daughter of Beri, the Hittite. So the fathers of these daughters that he married are different people. Different fathers, different descendants. So you can't say that they're all the same people. You cannot say that Esau had only three wives. He had to have, I think, a minimum of four. Minimum. And I think he had even more than that. I think he had like six wives, because you see two pairs of sisters. And then the daughter of, and then two others. Because Judith was separate and this Aholibamah was separate as well. And one thing that might be interesting about this is, you know, Esau was looking to Jacob a lot. What we saw already that when his wives were a grief of mind, he looked to what Jacob did and what pleased his parents, and that's why he took Ishmael. And he was looking to see that some of the things that Jacob was doing and copying that. When Jacob came back from Padan Aram, what did he do? He married sisters, right? Rachel and Leah were sisters. Now, that wasn't his plan, but he came back having two wives and all these children and his concubines as well. So he came back with the two wives and the two concubines, and his two wives were sisters. Well, who's to say Esau didn't see that and said, well, I'm going to have two sets of sisters, you know, to kind of one-up his brother. That's kind of what I think is probably going on here. That Jacob saw, or Esau saw what Jacob had done by marrying sisters, and he ended up marrying, then later on, he took more wives unto him after he came back. And now that's just, again, that's conjecture. That's my opinion. That's not, you know, gospel truth, that you can't prove that from the Bible. I don't see anywhere to prove that, because it's very limited where we even see the information on this. But I think that's very interesting to even see, well, how many wives did Esau have? And as you read your Bible, it's easy to skip over this stuff. It's easy just to not even think about it. But when you start matching things up and looking back and saying, I know I read about Esau having wives, let's just go back and just look at it. Just put them side by side, and you'll start, and the differences come up immediately. Now this Aholibamah, go back if you would just to Genesis 36, we're going to continue here. It says, Aholibamah was the daughter of Anna, the daughter of Zibeon the Hivite. So it's kind of interesting that he says it's the daughter of Anna, which was the daughter of Zibeon the Hivite. And you remember when we just read that story about Shechem, right? You remember when Jacob was in Shechem, and his daughter Dinah wanted to go out and see the daughters of the land. And that's when she got into trouble and committed fornication with Shechem, and all that mess happened, right? Well, I believe it was the daughters of the land, bad influence on Dinah, for one, to see what they were doing. And Shechem was a Hivite. And here we see Esau marrying a daughter of the Hivites. So someone of that same land. You remember Shechem, he was more honorable than all they in his house, right? And he's the one who was committing fornication with Dinah and then wanting to marry her. So it wasn't this high standard of morals that we saw by the Hivites in Shechem. And here we see Esau marrying Aholibamah, which was one of the Hivites, which was a daughter of the Hivites. So you can kind of see like we're already not good foundings for Esau's descendants based on the ancestors here. Now let's look, if you would, if you remember, well, where's that verse? As it starts going through now, I'm going to shift gears. As we start reading through the different children, does this name sound familiar to anyone? It says, and the sons of Eliphaz were Teman, Omar, Zephau, and Gatam, and Kenaz. If you remember in Job had three friends. Does anyone remember Eliphaz the Temanite? Right now, this isn't the same Eliphaz. Obviously, this is later on, because the Temanite, it says here that Eliphaz, that Teman was a son of Eliphaz. But you know, in family trees, oftentimes people will reuse the same names as ancestors. Right? You have a tendency to honor someone else in your family, and you'll name your child a same name as maybe a grandfather or a great-grandfather or a father, you know, and you kind of repeat using names. It's common. It happens even these days. You know, it's a common thing that happens. People will reuse names. So we saw Eliphaz the Temanite. So we know, and when you try to get this, it's, I'm going to try to be very clear about this. The book of Job is real interesting, because when you try to figure out, well, when did this take place? A lot of the books will tell you in the Minor Prophets, it says what kings were reigning. You get a good idea of the time frame. In the book of Job, there's some hints if you want to try to figure out, well, when did all of this take place? Now, a lot of the books of the Bible were written, like penned down, after the events of the Bible, right? So in Genesis, you know, Moses wrote down the words of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. But the events happened in many of the stories, you know, way before Moses. Remember, Moses came, you know, 400 years after Jacob, his time, yet Moses wrote down all these things that happened, all these events, all this history, all this stuff that happened. Moses wrote that down. So as you read, you'll see references, like when it calls Bethel, it says it used to be called Luz. Well, if they were writing this at the time it actually happened, they would be referring to places a little bit different. But because it was written afterwards, the places that they're referring to are places that made sense at the time that actually exist, that maybe didn't even exist when these things were happening, like geographic regions. Okay, you say, well, why are you telling me all this? Why are you saying this? Because the book of Job was written during a time, was written down after all these events happened. And the proof we have that, we could see in chapters 1 and chapter 2 of the book of Job, it refers to God as the Lord, Jehovah. When you see the Lord all in capitals in the Bible, that's the Bible's translation of Jehovah. It's Lord. So when you see the all caps, capital L-O-R-D, that's Jehovah in the Bible. We see in chapters 1 and 2 only the reference to the Lord, but then chapters 3 on, when it records the conversation between Job and his friends, like all the rest of the book, they refer to God as God Almighty, or the Almighty God, and not Jehovah. And Moses was actually the first person to hear that. He says, when Moses was talking to God in the burning bush, when he asked him, you know, who shall men say that I am? You know, or that who shall say has sent me? Well, you know, what's your name, God? He said, say I am that I am hath sent you. And he explains to Moses, he says, you know, your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, knew me by the name of God Almighty. But now he revealed his name of Jehovah unto Moses. So that's when Jehovah starts being used, is at the times of, after the times of Moses. From Moses on, that's when it's known. He wasn't known by his name, Jehovah, prior to Moses. And all of these events that are happening here, when Job is actually doing, because it records the literal quotes from Job and his friends, and these conversations they're having back and forth from Job 3, basic, almost to the end of the chapter when God speaks, or the end of the book, I mean. And every time it's referring to God Almighty. So we see that this is before, because they didn't know the name Jehovah. And we also see that in Job 1, it says there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. Well, the land of Uz, that comes from the name of a person. In Genesis 36, verse 28, it says the children of Dishan are these, Uz and Aran. So it came after these days of Jacob, right? Of this event in the story of Job. Happened after Israel and Jacob and Esau, because Uz had to be born in order to establish this land for it to be called the land of Uz that Job was living in. Right? And for his friend Eliphaz the Temanite to be there. If Eliphaz is a Temanite, then he's of the descendants and of the land of Teman, which was another descendant of Esau. Right? Does it all make sense? So we see these bits and pieces of evidence, and these are the things that are kind of the more digging down deep into the Bible and getting just a better understanding and looking at these events. And you know, it's not necessarily, you know, you might not think it's earth-shattering, but I think it's really cool just to get that more intimate knowledge of the Bible and understand what else is going on in history, because there's so many things that happen in the Bible concurrently. You read them as a separate book, and you don't think about putting them together and saying, wow, that's amazing. It's amazing when you think about how short of a span of time, especially around the book of the Kings and Jeremiah and Ezekiel and these great prophets, and God is just pouring out all of this wisdom during his time. And it's like, why are people just not listening? And God is so hard trying to talk to them before the destruction comes, before they get brought into captivity, before all these bad things happen. God is really trying to get their attention. And you start realizing, man, all of these books, I mean, these prophets are just prophesying and prophesying and prophesying, and people aren't listening. And when you keep that in mind as you read it, you say, you know what, this was happening during this time, this was the king, these are all the events that were happening in the kingdom. It just helps you to get a much better understanding of the Bible in general. And I urge you, if you've never done your own Bible study, but first of all, I urge you, if you haven't read the Bible cover to cover, you have to do that first. You have to read it, I would say, multiple times, cover to cover, just to get an idea of what the stories mean, and then start doing your Bible studies. Continue your regular reading, but whatever it is that interests you, there's all kinds of things. You know, a common thing is like looking at some of the genealogies and figuring out who is descended of who and who is related to who. I thought it was amazing when I learned for the first time how, because, you know, I learned this quite a while ago, but you start realizing, oh, David's, you know, that's his cousin is Joab, or his nephew is Joab, and all these other people that he had. You know, Joab was the captain of his host, but it's, you know, Zeruiah was his sister, and that's who gave birth to, you know, that was Joab's mother, so that's his nephew. And you start realizing all these people, and they're all related, and these families are related, just like the families of the King Saul were related, and all these people in positions of power and everything else. And you start to look at the characters in a different light when you realize all the different relations and stuff. So that's pretty neat. Now, continuing on here, Genesis 36, look at verse number 31. The Bible makes a point here. It says, and these are the kings that reigned in the land of Edom before there reigned any king over the children of Israel. So he's explaining, you know, these are, you know, the heathen land, and we know this from other scriptures as well, that they all had kings. Edom had kings, but the children of Israel didn't, because God's plan for Israel was the judges. It wasn't to have a king over the kingdom. He didn't want that. That's not the way that God's design was. His design was that, okay, there's one lawgiver, it's God, and they have the law. It was given to Moses. Here is the law, and this is what we need to follow. They don't need to be making up all these extra laws and all these other things to follow. God gave them what they needed. And I don't know why we think today we just need all of these different laws and effect and statutes and ordinances and all this other stuff. Look, man, I want to be free. God gave us the laws that we need. It's not that complicated. When people do wickedly, they get punished or they get killed or whatever the punishment is. When people steal, when you infringe on someone else's rights and do harm to someone else in one way or another, there's a punishment for it. It's real simple. It's a real simple concept. And when you look at the books of the law, you know, you could say the books of the law, the books of Moses, Genesis through Deuteronomy, it's not that big. But really, I mean, Genesis doesn't contain laws that we need to follow. So when you're talking about the, you know, we could say Exodus, it's not that much. Compare this law, this amount of laws, which is every single page in this section right here is not even all law. Compare that to the laws of Arizona, the laws of the United States, all the laws that exist on file. Compare that to this. I mean, you think about one law of our land, Obamacare, right? One law is way bigger than this, than these pages. You could read this in a day. That Obamacare law, they couldn't even read that in a day. They didn't even have time to read on it before they voted it. That's how ridiculous the state that we're in. That's how unfree we are. Because we have all these extremely long, confusing laws that we don't even need. God gave us his perfect law. He gave us what we need. Amen. And it's found in his law. And if we can just follow those simple laws that he has laid out for us, we don't need anything else. But we make it complicated because we don't follow God's law. Because murderers don't get put to death. Because pedophiles don't get put to death. Because rapists don't get put to death. Now you have to have all these other laws to deal with all the outcome of them not being punished properly. Now we have to have all these other laws dealing with things because people aren't getting the proper punishment they deserve the first time. God established a rule, a system of judges, but Israel ended up rejecting those judges. And Samuel was disappointed when they said, they're like, make a king after us, because they were expecting Samuel's sons to take Samuel's place. And they're saying, look, Samuel, your sons, they're not like you. You know, they're not men of integrity. Now, shame on Samuel for not raising his sons properly, but shame on them for even thinking that. You know, nowhere in the book of Judges do you see that it's just automatic hereditary rule. The judges were different judges were arising at different times from different tribes, from different people, whoever it was that rose to the occasion that was going to be that leader to lead Israel back to God and to defend them from their enemies that are coming in. It didn't matter where they came from. It was a judge that God was using, that God was ordaining to be their leader. Not just the son of the son of the son of the son, and just hereditary rule. That's not the way the judges worked. So these people already had a false concept of, well, why does Samuel's sons, if Samuel's sons aren't good enough to rule, then pick somebody else. Get someone else in there to judge. But you don't need to change your whole system of government because Samuel's children aren't up to par and just get a king. But no, God explained to Samuel, he says, you know what, Samuel, don't be upset. He says, they haven't rejected you. He said, they've rejected me, which ultimately in their hearts, that's what they did. They rejected God as being their ruler because God was the king of Israel. God handed down his law and he gave judges there to interpret the law, to just pass out the judgment and say, okay, this is God's law. God said this and let's hear the facts of the case. Okay, well, the facts apply in this way to the law. And that's all the judge's job was to do. But they rejected him and they wanted to have a king because you know why? They saw all the other nations. They said, oh wow, You know, the Edomites, they've got a king, and whenever someone comes to you know, wage war against them, their king goes out and fight for them. They like that. They wanted someone to go out and fight their battles for them. You know, when you have freedom, when you have true freedom and liberty, there's a lot of responsibility that goes along with that. You have to watch out for yourself. When you don't have this nanny state government taking care of you and saying, okay, well, we've got welfare, we've got Social Security, we've got all these different programs just to help you out and make sure that you don't screw things up too bad for yourself. And if you do, the government's here to help you out. By enslaving everybody in order to even do things like that, by taxing you, putting a gun to your head and saying, you better pay up this money, and if you don't, we're throwing you in a cage. Try not paying your taxes. Yeah, tell me it's voluntary tax system. You're in bondage. You can't even own property without paying taxes. That's paying rent. That's not you owning things. That's not your ownership. I don't own this land or this house. I'm still continuing to pay taxes on it. Regardless of a mortgage, you could have the whole thing just paid free and clear. Yet even just because I have this land, I can have the deed to this land, nope, you still have to pay taxes. You still have to pay it. Well, then that doesn't belong to me if I'm paying someone else because I own this. I don't own it. I'm paying rent to you. It's not freedom. God's laws are simple, but they rejected God, and they wanted to be just like Edom. And you know, and the Bible points it out there in Genesis 36 that these kings started popping up in the heathen lands before they ever came to Israel. Now let's look at verse 40. I'm going to be wrapping up here. There's one last major point I want to make on this chapter. As I mentioned earlier, you know, the dukes are the rulers of a smaller region. When you get down to verse 40, and it mentions the dukes in a couple of different places throughout this chapter, and there's some repetitiveness that goes on there. But I want to point out in chapter 40, look at what it's there in verse 40, excuse me, chapter 36, verse 40. Bob reads, and these are the names of the dukes that came of Esau according to their families, after their places by their names, Duke Timnah, Duke Elva, Duke Jeheth, Duke Aholibamah. Who was Aholibamah? You read through this whole chapter. Who's Aholibamah? Aholibamah was Esau's wife. His wife, Aholibamah. And in this chapter, Aholibamah was the daughter of Anna, the daughter of Zibeon the Hivite. So this daughter of someone from, you know, from a foreign land is now a duke. Is a ruler. And we wonder why Edom got so bad. And Duke Timnah. Who was Timnah? Timnah was, I think she was the concubine to Eliphaz. Let's see. I don't have that in my notes. But Timnah, yeah, verse 12. And Timnah was concubine to Eliphaz, Esau's son. And she bare to Eliphaz Amalek. And we all know how great the Amalekites are. Malachites were one of the groups of people that were cast out of the land that the children of Israel went to possess. And the Amalekites were also a wicked nation. And so we see here there's two women in this group that Esau had as rulers in this land. They were dukes. They were the ones in charge of their territory. Look, if you would, to Isaiah chapter 3. We're done with Genesis 36. We're not going to be coming back there. Look, turn if you would to Isaiah chapter 3. You say, well, what's the big deal about that? So what? So what if he had women ruling over an area? Well, again, maybe another verse you've never read in the Bible before, but the Bible says that having women rule in the land is a curse. That's a curse from God. Now, we have a female, a woman, running for president in our land. And she might very well win the sham election. I don't know. Isaiah chapter 3. Isaiah chapter 3. Look at verse number 11 of Isaiah chapter 3. The Bible reads, "Woe unto the wicked." So who are we talking about? The wicked. it shall be ill with him, for the reward of his hands shall be given him. He's saying basically he's going to reap what he sows. Verse 12, as for my people, children are their oppressors. Children are the ones that are oppressing his people, he says, and women rule over them. O my people, they which lead thee cause thee to err and destroy the way of thy paths. He said, when a country gets so wicked, they get so turned upside down, children become the oppressors instead of being in subjection, right? Instead of giving respect and heed unto the old generation, then the children become the oppressors. You remember what happened with Rehoboam, that Solomon's son, that the people came to him, and they said, Solomon made our workload real hard. Can you just lighten our load a little bit? And he says, no, I'm going to do even worse. I'm going to make your load even harder and basically oppress them. He lost the whole kingdom. They're like, well, forget you. We're not going to have any of this. Just because he tried to be like that. And the Bible's saying here, woe unto the wicked. Children are oppressing you and women rule over you. That's the signs of a wicked society. That's a curse from God. That's you receiving the reward of your hands. Well, people these days, they don't like to hear that. And they'll say, what do you mean? Now, women are just as good as men. Look, women are not ordained to be rulers. You say, well, what about Esther? What about people like Esther? There's an old book of the Bible called Esther. What about Esther? How much authority did Esther really have? Zero. You remember when Vashti was completely replaced because she didn't come when the king called her. The king called her, she didn't come. So the king was just like, Ahasuerus was just like, nope, you're done. You're not queen anymore. I'm just going to get a new one. Esther became queen. She couldn't even go and talk to him without being called. She didn't have authority. She wasn't ruling over people. She was a queen. Now, God placed her and God used her. Look, I'm not saying God can't use women. God can use women mightily to promote his will and his word and to do great things for God. Amen. Absolutely. But he's not going to place them in positions of power and ordain that is the power that he has set up. For example, God has set up the man to be in the position and the head in the household. And we already did an entire sermon regarding it. I'm not going to get into all that. But you say, well, what about Deborah? Right, Deborah was one of the judges of Israel. Turn, if you would, to Judges chapter 4. We'll see about that. Let's take a look. I'm not arguing that women don't have, I'm not saying that women don't have a place with God or in the Bible or can't do great things for God. Look, I know that they can. And they can be used all you may. But just because we see something that's happened in the Bible, doesn't make it right. Just because there is this woman, Deborah, that is a judge in Israel doesn't mean that she should have been. Look at Judges chapter 4, verse number 4. The Bible says, and Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lapidoth, she judged Israel at that time. That's a statement of fact. She did it. She judged Israel. That's true. Deborah was a judge in Israel. Verse 5, and she dwelt under the palm tree of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel and Mount Ephraim, and the children of Israel came up to her for judgment. And she sent and called Barak, the son of Abinoam, out of Kedesh Naphtali, and said unto him, hath not the Lord God of Israel commanded, saying, go and draw toward Mount Tabor, and take with thee 10,000 men of the children of Naphtali and of the children of Zebulun, and I will draw unto thee to the river Kishon Sisera, the captain of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his multitude, and I will deliver him into thine hand. So Deborah's calling Barak here and saying, look, hasn't God said, hasn't God commanded that you should go and do it? And she's talking to Barak, not saying that I should go and do this, not that Deborah should go and lead the people in this battle. She's saying, hasn't God said that you need to go and do this, Barak? Hasn't God said he's going to give Sisera and the whole host into your hand? Like, why aren't you going and doing this? This is what God said. But the men were so weak at that time, that's why they had, Barak should have been the judge. Barak is the one that should have been in charge, not Deborah. And Deborah's there just saying, like, look, shouldn't you be doing this? Verse 8 says, and Barak said unto her, if thou wilt go with me, then I will go. But if thou wilt not go with me, then I will not go. He's saying, oh, what a weakling, what a wimp. He needs to have a woman come with him to a battle? What is wrong with you, Barak? And, you know, if my name was Barak or Barak, I'd probably want to change it, because this is not a very good name to have when you're such a wimp that you can't even go to war without bringing a woman with you. Say, all the way I'm going to go is if you come with me. Go out and fight the stinking war. God told you to go and do it. God said he was going to be with you, and you need this woman to come with you? And because he did that, there was a repercussion. Look at verse number 9. And she said, I will surely go with thee. Notwithstanding, the journey that thou takest shall not be for thine honor. She said, well, you're not going to get the honor of this battle. You were going to, but now you're not. For the Lord shall sell Sisera into the hand of a woman. And Deborah arose and went with Barak to Kedesh. Now look, I'm not saying that Deborah was a bad person at all. I'm just saying she shouldn't have been the judge of Israel. And she, I think even she knew that when she's just trying to tell Barak, look, this is God said that you need to go and do this. Because what were the judges? I mean, think about the judges. Yes, they judge the law and they judge the people. But every time the children of Israel were being repressed, God would raise up a judge to deliver them. That was the judge's job, really, was the deliverance from these people. Well, Sisera was causing, you know, a problem with the children of Israel. So he's raising up a judge, and that judge was Barak. But Barak wasn't stepping into his job, so this woman had to go with him. And she even said, look, you're not going to get the honor for this now because you're being such a pansy. In not so many words. Right? Not trying to add to the Bible here, but that's basically what's going on. So you could bring up examples of women being used of God in the Bible. I don't have a problem with that, but they're not supposed to be in these positions of power. And why do I even say it? Where do I get my information from? Turn, if you would, to 1 Timothy chapter 2. 1 Timothy chapter 2. We saw the Edomites. The Edomites had dukes as women in charge, ruling over their nation. That's how we got on this subject, right? From Genesis 36. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. New Testament. New Testament teaching. Scripture. The Word of God. What does God want? What does God ordain? Look at verse number 9. In like manner also that women adorn themselves in modest apparel with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array, but which becometh women professing godliness with good works. Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection. Subjection means you are being under subjection. You are putting yourself beneath what's going on. You say, I'm going to learn in silence. I'm going to keep my mouth shut as a woman in church. Look at what he says in verse 12. Now you can say, well, that's talking about church, right? So why can't she be outside of church, being in a position of authority? But I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. So the Bible's saying that the woman is not supposed to usurp, take authority over the man. Why? Because the man is the one that's put in authority. The man is the one that's put in charge. That is who God has ordained to be in different positions of leadership and in charge and in power, is the man. That's what God wants. He says, it's not your job to usurp authority over the man. Yet we have these women that are constantly trying to usurp and take the authority of the man and just decide, well, I'm going to make all the decisions. That's not your job. That's not your role. God didn't make you to be a leader. He made you to be a homemaker, so you need to go back at home and take care of your kids and make some food and clean the house. Because that's your job. And there's nothing wrong with that job, and it's not demeaning. It's a great job. My kids are so extremely important, and their well-being and their upbringing is so important. There's nothing wrong with that job, but that is the woman's job. The man's job is to go out and lead. The man's job is to go out and make the money. And the man's job is to be in the positions of authority. And the woman's job is not to usurp the authority over the man, but rather to learn in silence from the man who's doing the preaching and the teaching. Turn, if you would, to 1 Peter chapter 3. It's the last place we'll turn. 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse number 1 reads, likewise, ye wives, be in subjection. There's that word again, subjection. You're being in subjection. You're not ruling over people. You're being ruled over. Be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wives, while they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear. Whose adorning? Let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair and of wearing of gold or putting on of apparel. Look at this, verse 4. But let it be the hidden man of the heart in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. That is what a godly woman should be like. Have adorned in an ornament of a meek and quiet spirit. Quiet spirit isn't telling everybody and teaching everybody and just being a loudmouth. But if you're going to be a ruler or a duke, you're not going to have the meek and quiet spirit. You're going to need to be able to lead. You're going to need to be able to tell people what to do. This is what we're doing. We're ruling. I'm leading you. Those are the attributes and qualities of a leader, which is not a godly woman. But Esau didn't have a problem with it. Esau didn't have a problem with a lot of things. And that was his problem. It was. There's his problem was he didn't have a problem with this stuff. He didn't have a problem with women leading. He didn't have a problem taking wives of the heathen. Didn't have a problem with any of it. He didn't have a problem selling his birthright. Well, until later on. Until he starts to see the ramifications of what he did. But even then, I mean, it didn't seem to be that big of a deal to him. We as God's people ought to take issue with this stuff. And that's why, you know, I'm done with voting anyways, but whenever I get the ballots and stuff, I go through, because the judges are actually really important, but how do you ever know anything about how a judge judges? Like, you can't just go sit down in the courthouse for a while and just listen to them and just see how they judge. But every time that I've ever voted on a judge now, like in recent years since I've learned this myself, I always vote to remove the women judges. Because I don't want to have women ruling over. I would hate to have something happen and then I go and I'm being judged by a woman. Again, it's nothing against a woman, but the Bible says that that's usurping authority over the man. And that's not right. That's not the way God designed it. For a good reason. And the Bible, you know, I didn't read the rest of these passages, but it says, you know, for the woman was deceived. The woman being deceived was in a transgression. She was the one that was tricked by the devil. Adam wasn't tricked. He did what was wrong, yes. He sinned. But he wasn't deceived by the serpent like Eve was. And that's just one of the, you know, God made us different. I know this isn't popular today. I know that women might take offense at this sermon and say, oh, I can't believe you said that about women. Oh, I can't believe you said it. I need to be raising my children and cooking. Look, take your issues up with God. Read the Bible for yourself. Does it say to be in subjection and to learn in silence or not? If that's what it says, then why do you do it? Then why do you go to these churches that have women pastors behind the pulpit trying to teach and usurp the authority over the man when the Bible clearly says that the pastor is to be the husband of one wife? Husband, not the wife of one husband, the husband of one wife. When the Bible says that that you should not suffer a woman to teach, and that even in Revelation, the Bible uses the same verbiage about Jezebel saying, you sufferest that woman to teach. And that was a bad thing. That was a negative thing. That was something that that church needed to repent of, was allowing that woman Jezebel to teach and to bring in her heresies and her false doctrine. And the fornication and everything else that was going on in that church. So we're not going to stand for it here, and neither should you. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you for the truth of your word. Dear God, I pray that you would please help us to stay anchored, to stay settled on your word in the midst of such a bizarre, wicked world. Dear God, there's so many things that are seen differently and taught differently and were brought up differently, dear God. Than these great truths and all the lies that are put out there that have become normal in our society, but they're not normal, dear God. They're not the way things should be. You've told us the way things should be. Please help us to learn more about your words, not be surprised when we read these things, but we can accept them to be normal for us in our lives, dear God, that your word is the standard that we need to be looking to when we make all of our judgments and all of our understanding and all of our knowledge, dear God, comes from your words. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.